You know what? I'll take care of it, too.
Surprise, surprise, that they're all... I'll write something out, somebody says something different. I gave up even keeping...
You get a cable bill today as well?
Exactly.
You're going to be able to get all the names, whatever you think.
As soon as they give them to me loud and clear, we should be okay. I've got my hand ready.
A minute or two.
There's still a few more seats down front, if anybody like come down, one there, three or four there, and a couple over on the side. That helped out the way you aligned us. Guess we're on the air, ready to go.
Still a minute off? Still a minute off?
Why start now?
Good evening. I believe we will start the meeting at 7:30, and I welcome all you people here. I think it's great to have such an interested group at a council meeting. Usually the staff and couple of people will take care of the audience, but tonight it's really interesting to see so many people here. So we'll start off with a roll call from the clerk.
Chairman Jordan.
Yep.
Councilor Chapel.
Yep.
Councilor Cogswell.
Here.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
Here.
Councilor Linnell.
Here.
Councilor Marvin.
Here.
And Councilor McLaughlin.
Here.
Thank you. This is meeting 8-94-95, January 9th, 1995 at 7:30 p.m. Will you all please rise and salute the flag? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have a couple of little announcements that we'd like to pass out or hand out, and I don't know.
It be for the old kid. Be for the old kid.
No.
We have a cake here, and I would like to congratulate the new and the old. We have a new member of the town of Cape Elizabeth from Councilor Marvin, and I would like to congratulate you. And
thank you.
I knew you was lucky and made it before the end of the year. Is that correct?
Pitocin is a wonderful thing, Bill. So.
And the next is the fine gentleman on my right here, the old man of the council, as I call
him. I'll get it, don't worry.
He's really must have been a bundle of joy for his mother on December 25th. So Irv is 75 years old on December 25th, and we want to congratulate him and wish him many more.
Thank you.
I haven't quite got there yet.
Give some to everybody?
Sure.
We're going to put it out back.
Maybe it'll sweeten them up a little. That's good.
Nice out back.
Oh, the knife is out back? I haven't got my jacket.
Got a knife out back. You can take a look at it. We'll put it up.
We'll cut it. We'll just take a look at it and cut it up back.
Okay. Okay. You got something?
Get it.
Sorry about the
Why knife. Do I get nervous?
We take them
back
when they're
out
of
eggs. Mike, drop it.
Mike will be careful. I don't think he does catering service or anything. Don't quit your day job, Mike.
Put it on top of the school.
Yeah. I think it's really good to get a camera shot of it, right?
So, we'll move on with the minutes of the meeting of 7/94/95. What's your wishes?
Move we approve the minutes as presented.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 7-0. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Does anybody here have anything they'd like to discuss that's not on the agenda? Or? If not, I guess we'll move on to reports and correspondence. And I have one thing to say, to congratulate the Signs of the Sunrise Chorus, the Cape Elizabeth Middle School, that performed at the governor's inauguration there. I think it was tremendous, and I think the people of Cape Elizabeth would be proud of them. Thank you. Is anybody else got anything they'd like to report?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
In order to keep this as short as I can on this end and get right into the things that we want to talk about tonight, I just want to give you a brief report on Regional Waste Services, what we're doing. The December 15th meeting, we had executive committee at 5 p.m. and a board meeting at 7 p.m. on the Baylor addition so that we can accommodate the recycling upgrade and discuss flow control, waste deliveries, and executive committee meeting that we held all day on December 13th concerning policy committee, the recycling task force, and the new bond issue, and all the financial statements, and it was quite a day. January meetings tomorrow night is the Recycling Task Force at 5 p.m. at the plant on Blueberry Road in Portland. The 11th of January is the Executive Committee meeting at 5 p.m. We're going to spot market waste, Recycle Task Force recommendations, Policy Task Force recommendations, and staff reports. And on the 15th, board report at 7 p.m., board meeting rather, at 7 p.m. So it's a busy month for us. I'll give you a full report in February when we don't have a large crowd that are not really too much interested in RWS, and I don't blame them. Thank you.
Anybody else? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just want to encourage councilors to consider attending the It's a dinner meeting with the Maine State legislators on Wednesday the 18th, which is next Wednesday. This is being sponsored by the Chamber of Commerce of the Greater Portland Region, the United Way of Greater Portland, Greater Portland Council of Governments, and the area educational institutions. And I think it's something that we would find worthy of attending. Also wanted to, it's a great night to have a lot of public here, let people know that we've been notified by the Cumberland County Extension Association that there is an opening on that executive committee for a member of, for a resident of Cape Elizabeth. If anybody is interested in getting more information about that position or in being nominated for that position, if you would please notify Town Hall within the next week, you can call the town clerk on that and we will see that your name gets forwarded to the county extension office. Also wanted to comment that included in our packets were the results of two customer surveys that have been done, I would say, in the past couple of months. One of them I know had to be because it was tied into the election. One was from voter registration, the other from the tax and licensing office. I want to thank the people who participated in the surveys. This was a wonderful way for the council and staff to get some good feedback about how we are doing, if we're performing up to your standards or not. It was also a good way because it was an other section in it where you could comment on other services provided by the town and just share your thoughts. I thank the people for filling that out. If you didn't get a survey and you want to share some of your thoughts on customer service, again, please contact either Town Hall or one of your counselors. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anybody else? If not, we'll move on to a public hearing. And what the public hearing is about authorizing the design of Shore Road Bikeway shoulder improvements and authorize the design of Two Lights Road Bikeway shoulder improvements, and I would like to handle them both at once. And when you were speaking, if you have a preference, just state that, and we'll try to get that down. And everyone here that is interested in speaking will get a chance to speak, and I hope to try to keep it in an orderly manner, and I hope you'd hold your applause until after we get done here and not trying to persuade different groups, as I feel that you give a louder applause to one side or the other, because I know there's going to be speakers here from both sides. And each one will have a chance, and according to the rules of the council, you have 5 minutes, and we'll be timing you. I don't know as many of them will take more than 5 minutes. So you'll rise and come to the podium and state your name and your address, and we'll try to record it. And everyone, who would like to be first? Right? Excuse me. Well, maybe that might be a good idea. Just a minute. Maybe that might be a good idea that the manager has got a few open remarks he would like, and maybe it would help some of your questions. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll try to keep this brief, but as many of you are aware, that you have had a lot of questions, and others of your neighbors have had questions. What I'd like to do is to go over very briefly the most of the most popular questions that folks have either called the town hall, or perhaps that you've called council members, and council members have related the questions to the town staff. Many folks asked about what is the history, how did this evolve, where did it come from? Over the 1980s, there were three separate studies done of bikeways in Cape Elizabeth, and particularly the Shore Road bikeway study itself, Shore Road. Back in 1982, there was a regional bikeway plan done, which showed community bikeways in both of these particular locations. In 1986, there was a Shore Road bikeway study done prepared by PACS, which is the Regional Transportation Planning Group. Subsequent to that, there were two additional studies done in the late 80s and the early 90s on Shore Road itself. There never has been a formal study done of a Two Lights Road bikeway. Back in fiscal year 1991, which for the town was 4 years ago, the town council set aside $100,000 in the municipal budget in order to start design and construction of a bikeway on Shore Road. Subsequently, those funds were, I think you used the word recaptured, as a result of when we went into the recession and suddenly we found out our revenue forecasts were overly optimistic. And at that point, the particular project was put on hold. Subsequent to that, many citizens have asked, where does it stand, where does it stand? We keep getting calls and questions. And back last year, there was a regional study done. Councilor Linnell participated on it, which again looked at needs and identified, again, these particular areas as ones that should be considered for bikeways. The town subsequently applied for grants, and much to our surprise, the grants were both received. We did not anticipate that both grants would be funded. As most of you have seen on the sheet as you've come in, both of these projects would be funded on an 80-20 basis, 20% by the local citizens of Cape Elizabeth and 80% by the citizens of the state and the nation through the state and federal grants. The projects combined have a budget of around $535,000. Exactly what is being proposed is a question that's come up quite a bit. That is a little bit uncertain. What's being proposed is that a design process commence. There's a couple of draft motions before the council, which some of you may have picked up in the back of the room. Those are really for discussion purposes only. No one has really put forward those motions. That was just something that the staff thought might be a point to help lead the discussion when the council actually began the process of debating. There has been some discussion and some articles in the newspaper indicating that the Two Lights bikeway was going to be on one side and be so many feet. There have been other letters that have been indicating that the Shore Road bikeway was going to be varying amounts of feet and varying amounts of buffer. What appears to be being considered is a bikeway on both sides of each road. On Shore Road, extending from Fort Williams Park up here to the town center, and on Two Lights Road, extending from Route 77 down to the state park. When would the projects be done? The way the grants work, any design could not begin until October of 1995, and then the way that would work and the length of time it would take construction could not occur until the construction season of 1997. Where do the local funds come from? Obviously, they come from local taxes and all the different other fees that the citizens of the community pay. Each year, the council sets aside a certain amount of funds for roadway and drainage improvements. This year, the amount is $150,000. That includes everything from paving the different roads to major reconstruction projects to providing matching grants for different projects. Again, there was an outline on the back table of how it's a possibility of how those towns might be spent over the next 5 years. Is there an effect on taxes? I was quoted in the newspaper saying there isn't an effect on taxes, and I was quite ashamed that I was quoted that way. Anything the town spends obviously has an effect on taxes, and while it may not actually increase the taxes, there's always the possibility of it reducing taxes or causing expenses not having to be spent on something else. So obviously it does have an effect. So, you know, if these weren't done, could the town lower taxes? Conceivably, yes, the taxes could be lowered. I've mentioned in the newspaper and other places that as a result of this possibly being funded, other projects are being delayed. Again, you can look at the sheet and you can see that what would really be delayed is a lot of miscellaneous paving. Unfortunately, an issue we have coming up in about 5 years is that many of the roads in Cape Elizabeth were all paved at the same time when the last sewer project was being done. All those roads are beginning to look like they may need work, and we really expect them to need work in about 5 years. And rather than to begin to address many of those in 2 or 3 years, as a result of doing this, would really be addressing them in 4 or 5 years. How much is the design and who pays for it? It's expected the design would range between 10% and 15% of the cost of each project. The projects would be then paid for the design as well on the 80-20 basis, the same as for the rest of the actual construction should that occur. If we don't use the funds, where will they go? They would go back into a state pool for reallocation statewide, as the commissioner of the Maine Department of Transportation would see fit. Would the town's relationship with the Maine Department of Transportation be hurt if we say no to their offer? This is one of the few questions that I think is more subjective and conjecture on my part rather than a definitive yes, no, or just numbers. And my sense is the town's relationship would not be hurt. They have done and tried many different projects in many different areas and realize that sometimes they run into difficulty and they move on to other issues, and I'm sure that would be the same with the Maine Department of Transportation in the town. What if the project costs more than the estimate? That would be something that would need to be negotiated with the state and with the federal highway at the time. It depends on overall what are the costs that are available. Those are most of the questions that have involved money and the funds. On design, are there certain federal strings, federal conditions that are attached to the grant? Yes, there are. If you do a bikeway, you are supposed to have a minimum of 4 feet on both sides of the road, or if you only have one single bikeway, it would have to be a bikeway of 10 feet. What should be the width? Should it be 4 feet, 5 feet, 6 feet, 10 feet? That is really a local decision and one that the town should decide on its own. I'm not suggesting that it should be 10 feet. That was just one of many numbers thrown out. Does the town have input in the process? Yes, in these projects, the town does. Ultimately, if this ever was designed, the council would eventually have to sign something called a local state agreement, and at that point, the town could say no. Furthermore, we have checked with the Maine Department of Transportation to see if there was a willingness to have a local town committee that would be reviewing the design, and they indicated that would be very agreeable to them. Would land have to be acquired? Frankly, we're not sure at this point whether or not land would have to be acquired. Again, the design has not been completed, and we're not totally sure of the exact right-of-way in the areas, and that would need to be surveyed. That also, what about stone walls, trees, lilac trees, drainage, wetlands? All of those issues would need to be addressed in the design. Obviously, if you put in a 4-foot shoulder that's paved, all of what I would call the scruffy area, not to define anyone's lawn, but the area that feels the effect of the town salt, where it's very difficult to grow grass and do all those things, all of that would then be moved in 4 feet because we would still pave, would still plow the snow off the shoulder. So really what you'd be looking at is whatever the width of the bikeway might be or the shoulder improvement, everything would be pushed that much further to the right as a result of the work. Who would be on the design review committee? That would be a judgment of the town council. The town council would determine the numbers who may serve, the process, as well as the process for appointment. What is before the council tonight? What is the council going to decide? One, I don't know. And two, it's really the council can do whatever it wants. It can pass something with conditions. It can pass something without a whole lot of conditions. It can vote to kill the project outright at this point, or the council could table it for more information. But really, the options are whatever really comes down to what a majority of four might vote upon. The final point I would like to make is it's been asked sometimes, does the staff have a position on this? And I think, you know, in speaking with different department heads and others, there are individual staff members who have personal opinions on whether or not this ought to be done. The chief of police I've had some discussions with, and he feels there may be a safety issue if you provide more traffic and more bikers and more walkers on Shore Road in particular. But, you know, as we further discuss it, it's, you know, I'm a little bit unsure what evidence there is to, you know, truly show that. And really what it came down to, I think all of the members of the staff really agreed that we probably have personal feelings about as much as everyone in the audience does. We all have our biases one way or the other. So for these particular items, the staff has not taken a position and does not plan to. So that's a summary of the primary information that we know at this point.
Thank you. Sorry, I forgot you.
Not a problem.
Okay, now I guess we would be ready to start the public hearing. Who would like to start?
Yes.
When you get to the podium, you can ask a question. Yes.
I think I need to ask a question first.
Take the podium, give your name and address, please.
My name is Charlotte Scott, and until October, I owned a house at 1107 Shore Road. At this point, I'm not a resident of Cape Elizabeth and don't know if I'm allowed to speak.
It's a regional issue.
I didn't quite get you.
Okay. Until October, I owned a house at 1107 Shore Road, but I'm one of those people who has moved from Cape Elizabeth since then.
How come you done that?
Taxes.
No, I would allow you to speak if you care to speak.
My answer was taxes, if someone didn't know. I am speaking as a former resident of Cape Elizabeth and a longtime observer of Shore Road. My name is Charlotte Scott, and for 8 years until this past October, I lived at 1107 Shore Road. That's the brick colonial at Pond Cove. Up front, I would like to say I do not favor the bike path on both sides of Shore Road. I have several reasons. Number one, I keep hearing all this talk about scenic views, the scenic ocean views along Shore Road. Well, there's only one small stretch of Shore Road where there's a view of the ocean. That was in front of my old house. The scenic ocean view lasts about 3 seconds in a car, perhaps 30 seconds if one bikes very slowly. Of course, the view lasts much longer if drivers park illegally than trespass on private property. And I can tell you more than a few bicyclists used to trespass, bring a lunch, a cold drink, a book to read, etc. If more people are encouraged to use Shore Road, I think the town needs to consider whether it's going to help property owners protect their privacy. Reason number two, and I think this is the most important, is safety. The road is indeed lovely, but much of what makes it lovely is what also makes it dangerous. The beautiful trees which line a good portion of the road between Fort Williams and Pond Cove cast deadly long shadows on the pavement. Unless the trees are removed, it will still be next to impossible to see pedestrians or bicyclists at certain times of the day. The twists and turns and blind curves cannot be removed, nor can Mother Nature's little obstacles. Last year, a man bicycling near my old home took quite a spill. It wasn't because of the absence of a bike path, but rather because his bike tire encountered an acorn. The area being considered for the bike path is nestled between two wonderful tourist attractions, Fort Williams and Two Lights. Because so many people who visit the places are from away, a disproportionate number of people unfamiliar with Shore Road travel it. Many a time I've seen the mystified tourist driving by, his eyes searching for clues as to where he might see that lighthouse. As signage is not bountiful and lighthouses are rarely found in the middle of the road, drivers' eyes are anywhere but on the road. Local drivers, teenagers, pardon me, but they honk, gun their motors, revving past the meandering sightseers. Spending $400,000 will not keep cars from speeding, passing illegally, and doing U-turns. I have watched baby ducks get squashed, turtles flipped off the road, raccoons and foxes killed by speeding drivers. Thank God it hasn't been a child. No matter how many bike paths are created, Shore Road is never going to be a safe place for bicyclists. My third and final reason is the cost. Most bicyclists I met, albeit trespassing on Shore Road, were from Scarborough, South Portland, and Portland. They parked at Mill Creek and biked out to the Cape. I don't know if a study has been done to determine who uses Shore Road for bicycling, and I knew some neighbors did. Does anyone have an idea how many Cape Elizabeth residents bicycle on the road? After observing the road for 8 years, I would estimate on most days I saw no people bicycle on the road. The most people I ever counted in one day was on a Saturday, and that was including the Saturday morning 9 a.m. biking group. There were 32 people in that entire day, plus 8 motorcycles. I don't feel it justifies an expenditure of over $400,000, and I don't care if $300,000 is in federal money. I pay those taxes. If scads of people don't use the road, with the bike path encourage more people? If so, is that what people want? I used to walk the road most every morning at 6 a.m. to avoid traffic and to feel safe. I found the road was just fine. I would not have biked there any more than I would have played badminton on it. I feel very strongly that pumping $400,000 into bike paths will encourage bicyclists to believe it's a safe place to go. I don't believe it will be. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Right here. I'm sorry. My finger didn't want.
I'm Pete Rand, living at 1222 Shore Road, and although obviously that address gives me cause to be concerned about this plan, I'm going to leave the protection of our own lilac trees to my good wife and my neighbors to discuss, and rather come at you from the generic point of view of Cape Elizabeth's rural nature and remind you that now twice in comprehensive plans in 1980 and now in 1993, that preservation of the Cape's remaining rural character and scenic beauty has been the number one goal of both of these plans. More specifically, this last one in 1993 referred, in fact, to Shore Road. And the first goal, just briefly to quote, is to protect the town's scenic areas and vistas. The town's rural character is largely defined by the existing scenic vistas and open space areas. The results of a public opinion survey confirm the judgment of the town council that most people react adversely to development because of its negative impact on important scenic views and open spaces. The public opinion survey results also identify large numbers of visually significant views and open spaces, such as the Spurwink Marsh, Shore Road, and then a number of others, including Crescent Beach and Fort Williams. Further in that document, under recommendations in the transportation section, there are some further specific recommendations that you folks approved last year. They were to revise the town's arterial feeder street classifications so that they more accurately correspond to current and future road extension policies. One, retain existing trees, stone walls, rock outcroppings, and other natural cultural features when undertaking road improvements. revise the existing dimensional and construction standards for arterial feeder and local roads in order to provide flexibility to ensure that future road improvements result in minimal loss of the town's rural character. Revision should include reduce the traveled way and shoulder width standards for all roads except for arterial roads, and eliminate the town standard that requires the entire right-of-way be cleared of trees and vegetation. I don't see how you really can consider what is being planned in the light of your approval of the comprehensive plan of 1993. The next issue would be public health, and one might presume perhaps that widening Shore Road is going to decrease the risk to public health, but I rather doubt that because I believe it's going to increase the velocity of the cars on Shore Road. I came home tonight by way of Fickett Street in South Portland and came down onto Sawyer Road, and my car just automatically went 10 miles an hour faster when it hit that smooth stretch that we can thank our Department of Transportation for. If Shore Road is a straight downhill run from the Girl Scout House down to Pond Cove. People are like skiers poling on a downhill race going by our house as they start down that ride. But as they get down a little bit beyond Todd Road, the road takes about a 35-degree angle to the left, and as a result of that, our good friend Al Elkins has had his fence wiped out at least three times in the last 10 years, and I'm afraid if since velocity is directly related to centrifugal force that he's going to have a whole lot more visitors if we widen the road in that area. You can't really come up here unless you have some suggestions for alternatives, and of course my alternatives to reduce the risk on Shore Road would be to apply speed limits to it, and my other suggestion would be to apply the funds that you are going to put onto Shore Road to improving by getting people off, the pedestrians and the bicyclists off the road by utilizing the town's green belt in areas that have already been defined to you as areas that may be available for that. Finally, I would like to say that if this in fact does pass, that there should be a stipulation that there is no partaking of private land, and further that if any walls or vegetations are moved, regardless of whether they're in the right-of-way or on private land, that the cost of those movements and renovations be covered by the project. Thank you.
Yes, this gentleman right here.
My name is Gregory Walsh. I live on Belfield Road, and I too would like to urge you to not authorize the plan proposals. My reasons are slightly different. I feel we have, as a town, no business spending federal money on a project like this. As much as we all like bike paths, we are, all of us, facing a monumental federal budget deficit. And I think the best thing we can do to help our federal legislatures reduce the deficit and to balance the federal budget would be to stop spending money. And I think that this money has been appropriated, I know, but it's not too late for us to just stand up and put our hand out and say, well, this is federal money, we're not going to spend it, because if we're going to reduce the federal deficit, it has to begin in our own backyards. Thank you.
My name's Harold Pacious. I live at 882 Shore Road, and I strongly favor the bikeways. As I understand what the manager said, this can be very much a two-step process. Tonight, the council, I'm sure, will be interested in knowing whether there are a significant number of citizens in Cape Elizabeth who would like to have this recreational facility and to do it on Shore Road, which is, in fact, a very pretty place to walk or to bicycle. Then, as I understand it, if the design process is authorized, then there will be a committee made up of citizens of Cape Elizabeth who will work on the design, and nothing will be built until the town council approves a design. So it is possible for the citizens to express a desire to have this process begin and to see whether they can be delivered a bikeway plan. And then it is just as possible that at the end of that process, it will be determined that it can't be done. I think the issue here tonight is whether it should be done. And let me say also that it isn't just because I'm a Democrat that I don't oppose the spending of federal funds. I suspect that if we said no to all federal funds in the town, a lot of projects would be affected, including some funds that go from the federal government to the State Department of Education to our town. Not for that school, mind you, but for but for other things. Now, if this is the beginning of the process to determine whether we want a bikeway, then I think it is important to listen to the people. I like to bicycle. I find it disconcerting at best, fearful at worst to bicycle on Shore Road. I think it is one of the most prettiest, I think it's one of the prettiest places there is to bicycle. There aren't many places to bicycle. People say, well, Mr. Patius, if you think that it's dangerous there, why don't you go over Mitchell Road? That's dangerous, just as dangerous. We live at one end of the Cape. We have children who are growing up here and one who has grown up here who have friends in other parts of the Cape. We would like them to be able to communicate, to walk or to ride their bicycle to the other end of the Cape Elizabeth. I think that these bikeways will be a connector for this community and an important connector. And so I would hope that there would be an opportunity for my children and the children of others to have this opportunity. People have said, and someone just a moment ago said, well, it's a dangerous road and cars go too fast. Cars go too fast on all of the streets of Cape Elizabeth. That's not a question of what should we ban pedestrians and bikers because cars go too fast. I think that's another issue. If the cars go too fast, we got to figure out a way to regulate it. We can't just turn over the town 100% to the automobile. This is a suburban community, and unfortunately, it is given over almost entirely to the automobile. I have in front of my house, I believe, the only lengthy sidewalk in this community. I have never seen a sidewalk anywhere outside of New York City that is more heavily used than that sidewalk. People want to get out and walk and exercise, and this will extend the opportunity. Now, I think that change is difficult for people. I think that everyone is fearful of change. I know I've lived in this community, not as long as he has, but for 52 years, and a lot's changed. Used to have a trolley car on Shore Road. I think in the future, however, future citizens of this community will thank you for your vision if you have created something that connects both ends of the town, permits children to safely navigate to their friends' homes, and gives an opportunity for people in the community, and even people in other communities, frankly, to enjoy what the town has to offer outside of the automobile. Thank you.
Yes, this lady right here.
Ruth Pitsley, 24 Old Fort Road. I cannot believe that we are planning to exchange $500,000 roughly for approximately 2 miles of black macadam when the process will in part destroy what makes this a special place. And I don't want to spend much time waxing poetic about that lovely winding road and the moss-covered stone walls and the majestic stand of evergreens and the beautiful mature lilac hedge that scents the spring breeze. But are we so unaware, or is it unappreciative of our heritage? Of course, if you absolutely have to get there 5 minutes faster, there's 77, our superhighway that goes from one end of Cape Elizabeth to the other and has adequate, wide, safe bikeways. But back to that $500,000. We mustn't think of it as manna from heaven, which I think we tend to do. It's more like pork from Washington, and we can't afford it, and we shouldn't encourage Washington to give it to us. I think the temper of our times will make heroes of those who have the courage to be fiscally responsible. We should simply say no thank you, and to make a suggestion and not leave without offering some solution, have we really given this enough thought? Have we explored other possibilities? Here's an idea. What about making Shore Road one way? A scenic route safe for cars, bikes, pedestrians, mothers with baby carriages, and yours for the price of a street sign. Thank you.
Thank you. Somebody over here. Yes, right here. I'm going to try to go from there, there, and up here.
Yeah, get up here.
My name is Bob Schumann. I live at 16 Delano Park. Others are going to address and have addressed the very real issues of safety and aesthetics. I want to talk about the fiscal aspect. The conventional wisdom that is that the winds of conservatism swept the country last fall. Last November's election foretold real fiscal changes. Much of what that means is still unclear, but it is safe to bet that at a minimum there will be less money coming down from the federal to the state level and from the state to municipal governments. Our expense of government comes by many paths, but it all ends up at our doors. One of those over which we have the least control is the unfunded mandate. Three examples that Cape Elizabeth didn't invent, but that we still have, are emissions testing, mandated by the federal government, works down to the state, the $24 that you pay out of your pocket to have your emissions checked is an example of an unfunded mandate. It cost us money. Water purity came down from the federal government, eventually to the water district. Your water bill is higher than it used to be. The dump closing, mandated by the federal government through the state, to the Cape, to the citizen. Future mandates may be unclear, but with each level of government looking for ways to shed expense, it is a good bet that we will see more, not fewer, of them. As these roll down to Cape Elizabeth, we have only our local real estate tax to rely on. We can't levy a local income tax or a local sales tax. We have only the tender mercies of Jerry Daigle. In 7 years, my taxes have gone up 3.5 times. I'm retired, I'm on a fixed income. How much more will it take to make Cape Elizabeth unlivable? We must be willing to draw the line between what we need to have and what is nice to have. It would be fiscally irresponsible, in my opinion, to keep adding unnecessary, even if nice, expense to our taxpayers when the taxable potential is limited and the stream of uncontrollable directives and our own already assumed obligations requiring us to spend lie before us. I suggest only two of these. If a general deterioration of the school and a population bulge has required us to improve and enlarge the lower and middle schools to the tune of $18 million, including interest, is it not inevitable that the high school lies ahead? Second, a larger school facility will require, virtually forever, increased operating and maintenance expense. There's only one place for these obligations to be met, and that's in your tax bill. My request to the town council is, we don't need, nor can we afford, a bike path on Shore Road when one, little used, already exists on Route 77. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, right, yes. See, anybody up there that would like to speak? I don't want to miss it. Okay, I'll be next.
Mr. Chairman. My name is Louis Cyrillus. I've resided on Shore Road in Birch Knolls for over 30 years. I had a number of items to discuss with the council this evening, but many of them have been discussed by the former speakers. I have witnessed many changes in Cape Elizabeth during these 30 years, all of them affecting the quality of life in our community. Some very beneficial to the citizens and to the community as a whole. Others of questionable, but very much all very expensive. And requiring an increase in the tax rate, which affected the quality of life for all, especially the senior citizens living in a fixed income. I think that we all recognize that. Among these important is the high school and the many and the money, which I left my glasses home, so therefore I seem to stumble. Please excuse me. At my age, I shouldn't be walking around without glasses. Fine, thank you. I can read, but I do not want to have a word that I didn't want to use. Thank you, I can see with, yes, thank you. Among these improvements is the high school, voted by many whom I'll wager are no longer residents of Cape Elizabeth. It is a superb building, which we're still paying for. Unfortunately, it was not available to my daughter, who became a National Merit Finalist and Merit Scholar, from the old building. Which goes to show that there is something to be said about the individuals and the teachers, no matter where they are. Additional expenses and improvements to the sewer extension in 1987 on Spurwick Avenue, and last year, the majestic $18 million school construction project, which again reflect concern with the quality of life here in Cape Elizabeth. Even though the tax increases have created a severe stress condition on our senior citizens on fixed incomes and their quality of life. Among little known improvements was the construction of a sidewalk on Shore Road to provide a walking and jogging route. Although I supported this improvement, I lost two very valuable and productive choke cherry trees, which provided a wonderful source of jelly. But now, with the ominous prospect of a tax hike because of the Cumberland County jail costs and other unforeseen tax surprises, I, for one, urge the council to disapprove the spending of money for this proposed bike path. We only have to look in the newspaper to see what is happening to other communities. Brunswick, Old Orchard, certain types of Cumberland County jail costs. It is getting to the point where the expenditure of funds is going to be a devastation upon a large percentage of our population, which have not been addressed. And I'm talking again on senior citizens. They're living on fixed income and were too embarrassed to come before the council or in open session to say that they were against anything. They were too embarrassed for fear that they would be told that they were against education, that they were against any kind of progress. Well, the time has come to put this on the floor and say senior citizens also demand some consideration, because they too have contributed for many years to the quality of life in our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman over here.
Good evening. My name is Don Burrows, and I live on Beach Bluff Terrace. I lived for 8 years on Old Ford Road. I like to run, and in the summertime I can run in the woods near my house, and I don't have to run on the street at all, and that's very nice, except for a little stretch up Shore Road. But now with the snow, I have to run on Shore Road, and I find it very dangerous. It's very hard to run on Shore Road. Excuse me, I don't have a prepared speech. It's very dangerous to run on Shore Road. There are places where you have to cross over to get to where there's enough room to get out of the way of the cars. I have children that I would like to be able to maybe have them walk to school one day. And it's only 8/10 of a mile from my house to Pond Cove, and it would be very nice if they could walk to school occasionally, but I wouldn't dare send them out on Shore Road the way it is now. I have two questions. Number one, how much will it cost the town to find out if, in fact, it turned out that the project was too expensive? How much would it cost the town to find that out? And would any of that be reimbursed by the federal funds? Can anyone answer that?
You want me to do them later?
How much will it cost for the town to find out if the project is too expensive? That would, you know, be a part, the ongoing part of design, and as I indicated, it'd be 10% to 15% of the project cost would be for design.
But even if the project didn't go ahead, would that cost still be covered?
The cost would still be covered, provided there was some legitimate reason, you know, that was identified through the process of the town saying no. Mm-hmm. If the town, you know, nothing really came up, and you know, the town just. The state protects myself a little bit.
I understand. I follow you. My other question is, in view of all the people here, would it be worthwhile to just ask for a show of hands at some point for support, for and against?
No, I think we'd like to let the other people speak.
I mean, after everyone has spoken.
Yes.
Could we do that?
I think we could do it after that, but I don't know what it would accomplish. But
well,
you get the feeling when you hear the speakers of which way they are for or against.
Well, it seems like a lot of the speakers are very prepared and very motivated. Maybe there are a lot of people who aren't as motivated, but, you know, would like to be heard just through a show of hands. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Yes.
Good evening, members of the town council. I think some of the supporters are feeling that the people who are opposed are outnumbering us, so I think that's why some of us are getting a little antsy. I'm Rosemary Reed. I live at 1 Dean Way in Cape Elizabeth. And my comments are prepared because they are 3 minutes and 45 seconds, and if I don't read them, it'll be longer. But I'd like to take the first minute to say that in addition to the, 385 signatures that you received today or last night, we have some additional petitions that have been received today, totaling 433 signatures of people in the town, some who do live in the areas and some who don't, who support the town council's consideration in favor of proceeding with the project. If I may pass these to the town clerk while I catch my breath. Thank you. The citizens of Cape Elizabeth are diverse in terms of their needs, their preferences, and their willingness to make improvements to our town. This is very apparent this evening. But this is an opportunity to make a decision for a long term while addressing short-term problems. Quality of life means different things to almost everyone. But in the years I've served Cape Elizabeth, I have heard repeatedly that people mention the high-quality housing, the fine schools, and public safety when defining the quality of life that draws them and keeps them in Cape Elizabeth. I would like to know how priorities for spending and raising funds would be characterized if this opportunity for an 80% subsidy, which is unlikely to be available again in Cape Elizabeth, were passed up. This grant is a return of some of our state and federal dollars that we did not receive for projects such as the school. When the town council positions itself to make this policy decision, it will take into account value with that outlay, increase pedestrian and vehicular safety through traffic design and enforcement, as well as environmental protection concerns. Many older adults may see this project as a youth-oriented project. That may not be essential. I hope that the council sees this as a much broader appeal. In this community, reliance on the residential property tax is continually considered by the council in setting the tax rate. where a large percentage of the burden is already on property taxpayers, it seems prudent to take intergovernmental aid when granted for a project that was applied for as long as 5 years ago. It took us 5 years to get this money. The work will take two more. Does anyone believe that if this opportunity is missed, conditions on Shore Road will improve? What about risk taken when kids ride or go on foot to Playstead Park or Fort Williams to play ball? There are currently 150 more students in our school today than in October of 1990 when I was on the town council. As a town, we are encouraging more people to use Fort Williams. The museum and current parking lot improvements are examples of our desire to get more people to use Fort Williams comfortably. Don't we have a problem with vehicular traffic when we hold events at Fort Williams? Aren't we trying to improve the town center for pedestrian traffic? Aren't we trying to start a pathway down Shore Road? Why should we stop at 1226? Why have a bikeway along Route 77 to take people to dangerous roads that they need to bike on in order to reach their destination? Why pass up the opportunity to complete work that has been under consideration for almost a decade? As for the use of the issue of increased speed by vehicular traffic, in my view, that is an enforcement issue. By improving sight distances, providing the pedestrian walkway, bikeway, we will improve safety for both non-vehicular and vehicular traffic. Rejection of this grant would set a precedent in the state, according to a recent Portland Press Herald article. Is this the type of precedent we want to set? This project will benefit the entire community. Some individuals may not be happy for personal reasons, but the community as a whole has the most at stake with these projects. I respectfully ask the council to vote to approve the grant and to allocate the local share and to begin the design process for these improvements. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry, but I can't pick out the ones that is yes and the one that no, and I understood your info to start with. Yes, this gentleman right here.
I'm Frank Meter. I live at Orchard Road. The problem I have with this whole project is one that's been addressed by several of the people here, and that's the price. I'm seeing over $530,000 and told that it might cost us another $10,000 to $15,000 for the design stage. I don't know if all of you people realize it, but evidently we're all ratepayers, and there's a lot of utility work that has to be done on that project. The relocation of poles, hydrants, some of your own meter boxes, etc. That cost comes to us through the rates that we pay. And as they've said, we're all soon coming up on retirement age, and we have to look at those costs. I don't know if this project can really be done for the $530,000 that we're looking at here. Not when DeLuca Hoffman had mentioned some 500 some odd cubic yards of ledge, if I'm not mistaken, in their original study.
Yeah, there have been a number of studies, all of which have different estimates, but the DeLuca Hoffman study did indicate, as the paper indicated, an extensive amount of gravel and extensive amount of stone walls and other effects.
Was that price included in these estimates here?
It's assuming, yeah, for a narrower bikeway, you get it lower. It does assume that.
Okay, so it's assuming the 500,000, the 500 cubic yards of ledge.
It'd be a little less than that because of it's not as wide as that study contemplated.
Okay. Like I say, I have a problem with spending this amount of money plus all the utility involvement when we have to question our dump pickup in the fall to save $55,000. When I look at this here, that we're going to spend probably well over $500,000 on this bike path, and I just don't think it'll improve the safety on that highway. You're not taking out any curves. You're not really changing any elevations, you're probably promoting danger by making it a bike path. Thank you.
Thank you. Right over here, this lady down. Yes.
It was an offer of glasses.
You want to borrow mine, or you'd rather have Nancy?
Mine over there.
Oh, excuse me.
Thank you, council members, for hearing us all tonight. My name is Louise Sullivan. I live on Two Lights Road for a little change of pace here. However, I did live for 10 years on Shore Road before I've lived for 8 years on Two Lights Road, so I've lived in both places. I'm a bicycle commuter, and I've traveled extensively on bicycles. And I have first a question for Mr. McGovern. Is Two Lights Road a town road?
The Two Lights Road has a divided maintenance responsibility. Portions of it are state, portions are town. The state is predominantly responsible for what they would refer to as summer maintenance, and we're responsible for winter maintenance. Mm.
And would the town be free then to decide that a four-foot lane on either side of Two Lights Road would suffice?
The understandings that I have received from the design division at the Maine Department of Transportation is that they would be very receptive to the town's input, as I described earlier.
Mm-hmm. And not require the six-foot thing that is on Route 77.
Yeah, the one on Route 77, I think, ranges 6 to 8 feet.
Six
a lot of it's
eight.
8 feet.
It's big. Well, Two Lights Road represents the oldest neighborhood in Cape Elizabeth, and the neighborhood from which Cape Elizabeth started, from which it grew. Many of the oldest houses in Cape Elizabeth are there, and many of those sit very close to the road, as you know. My own house, for example, if we were to move 6 feet closer to my living room, it would put the utility pole and the fire hydrant, I think, right in the middle of the living room almost. I'd be sad to see that happen. I'd be sad personally to lose more of my front yard. But more than that, I would be sad to see the rural character of Two Lights Road changed. And Two Lights Road, which is now already a big and pretty fast road, made into a bigger and faster road with the addition of wide shoulders. I don't think that it's necessary to have a bicycle path there. Two Lights Road is wide open. You can see almost the whole way, and cars coming down the road have good visibility. I do think it would be great if we could reduce the speed of cars traveling on Two Lights Road and treat it as a neighborhood road, which it rightly is. So for those reasons, I hope that you choose not to have bike paths on Two Lights Road. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman way down back there, he's been stretching his arm quite a few times, anxious to go.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
My name's Harvey Rosenfeld, and I live on 9 Glen Avenue in Cape Elizabeth. I'm here for a sort of selfish reason. I think you all know where Glen Avenue is. It's the first left offshore road as you come into Cape Elizabeth from South Portland. And I have the maybe unfortunate pleasure sometimes, and not very much pleasure, to both ride my bike and drive on Shore Road, and both of those are equally scary and hazardous. Riding a bike on Shore Road is dangerous because of the size of the road and the width of the road and how close the cars pass. Driving is bad because people ride bicycles on Shore Road, jog, rollerblade, and walk, and you come around the corners and you don't see them. And often you will go into the middle of the road to avoid people who you don't see. For both of those reasons, I urge the council to adopt a plan for the bike path, at least on Shore Road, and I'm not as familiar with the other road. Two things came up that I'd like to comment on that were mentioned tonight, two issues that people seem to have against building the bike path. One is safety, and I don't really understand that. I think Shore Road would be far safer with the bike paths and get pedestrians, bikers like myself, joggers, and all those people off the travel lane. But more importantly, people have said that will increase the speed on Shore Road. I think that's very easily handled by more enforcement. The other issue that people keep speaking about is fiscal responsibility. And I applaud the council's actions in that part, but fiscal responsibility doesn't mean simply saying no to expenditures. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth for 8 years, and I don't remember anyone being hurt or killed on Shore Road. I think that's a lot of luck. Someone is going to be hit by a car. When that happens, I think there's going to be an outcry in this community to make the road safer. Right now, you have a chance to build the bike path and only pay 20% of its cost. 2 years down the road, when a child is hit, and people say that road has to be made safer, these funds probably aren't available. Fiscal responsibility to me means spending money sensibly on important projects and necessary projects. The bike path to me, and I think to my neighbors, is a very important project. If we can build that and only pay 20% of the cost, then we're acting in a very responsible way. I hope the council will see it that way and support building the bike paths. Thank you.
We got a lady over here, I believe, was.
I'm Jean Montesano, the newest resident of Cottage Farms Road, but prior to that, Sherwood Forest. I speak as a citizen, taxpayer, cyclist, and most importantly, a parent. I am speaking in support of the pedestrian and the bikeway. My children and I have biked throughout Maine and New England states, and in all of our travels, we found that Shore Road to be the most dangerous. As a driver, one finds that it has numerous curves and blind spots, and there's no safe shoulder when one encounters people on bikes. I have a 12-year-old who's with me tonight and a 15-year-old that share my love of biking. They have both demonstrated safe bike habits, and they ride cautiously, but I do not allow them to ride on Shore Road. I worry that they will not be seen by the driver of a vehicle. This diminishes their freedom of getting to school. It reduces their time at school practices, sport practices, because they need to count on me, and it doesn't give them time to be with friends. I heard Mr. Patius share the same belief as myself, and I do support Mr. Rand's belief up the green belt, but each time we get into the trail system, we come across another house in Stonegate that stops us. Since I've lived in the Fort Williams area for the past 4.5 years, I have used Shore Road excessively. I've witnessed drivers come upon cyclists. They would be sharing the same lane, only to have an oncoming car in the opposite lane. This creates a life-threatening situation for people on bicycles. Because I depend on traveling on Shore Road, I'm alert to its design. Our numerous vacationers and sightseers do not drive with such knowledge. It is for this reason I feel that we're flirting with the danger without a bike shoulder. I have in my hand what's frequently the very first cycling book that's picked up by many families. This particular book is a guide, and it boasts the scenic beauty of Cape Elizabeth on Map 3. Its warning is simply this, quote, "Watch out for traffic nearing points of interest." This is on Shore Road. Certainly it's a careful bike rider that's aware of traffic and vehicles around him or her, but this warning diminishes the safety issues that Shore Road poses, and these unsuspecting bike riders will venture onto this route. I ask that this plan be supported by the council from a safety standpoint. I do believe that its design needs to be considerate of the landowners and their properties and need to take into account the aesthetics of Shore Road. Thank you.
This gentleman right here.
My name's Steve Barber. I've lived in the town for about 35 years, split between Shore Road and Two Lights Road. And I'd like to say that as a...
Your address now is Shore Road?
Is Two Lights Road.
Two Lights Road.
And as a kid growing up, we didn't have a lot of, or a neighborhood. And so I was one of the people that was on Shore Road visiting friends. I'd go down to Oakhurst Road or up by the school into Brentwood, and it was very dangerous. And now as a parent with three children, one of my concerns is on Two Lights Road with the traffic that is going down that road, that there isn't a bike path, and my children, in order to play with their friends, are going to get on that road, and it's something that I just don't want to see happen. I also don't want to force my children to stay at home all the time, and so the bike path would be great for them. In some of the comments that other people were making about getting out and freedom for them and the safety of our children, I think, is the key point here. So thank you.
We have a lady down here, way back in the seating.
Hello, Council. My name is Susan Poulin. I live at 58 Two Lights Road and have so for 10 years. My husband and I sent a letter to Mr. McGovern in the fall of 93 requesting a bike pedestrian pathway be constructed. I didn't have much response from him at the time. I then contacted Augusta and talked with some people there who were forming the PACS committee, which is the Bicycle Pathway Committee. And then recently learned that the funds that Augusta had approved for Cape Elizabeth were here. I then decided, well, it's time to act, and I got on my bicycle and cruised down Two Lights Road, dodging the traffic as I was going, and I went door to door with a petition, and virtually every door that I knocked on, people were very supportive of this bicycle pedestrian pathway. I then went to the IGA one Saturday and stood there for 3 hours and got numerous signatures from that. People that I approached were glad that I was there, wanted to sign right away, and after that, you know, I felt I wanted to show you members that what kind of support I had. I think that also we need to know that as I travel through other towns, Scarborough, Falmouth, Yarmouth, they all have wonderful bike pedestrian pathways. Look at Route 88 in Falmouth. We're concerned here with the aesthetics of ruining the character of Shore Road and Two Lights Road. Take a look at Route 88 in Falmouth. Do you think that the aesthetics have been ruined with that pathway there? I really urge your support. I hope we can have it. Thank you.
Thank you. This gentleman right here.
I'm Dr. Pitsley of Old Fort Road.
Speak up a little, please.
I want you to think of one thing.
Give us your name and address.
How many lawsuits you're going to be involved in. Because consider what happened to Portland High School.
Give us your name and address, please, first.
Dr. Pitsley, Old Fort Road.
Okay.
And that's the big thing that's going to happen, because the walls aren't going to be like they were, and you're going to get sued, but good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Lady standing back there has in a gray sweater. Okay, either one. Well, all the family, you can take care of it in one speech.
My name's Katie Keith, and I live at 8 Seabarn Road. I moved to this town 2 years ago, although the rest of my family's been here for about 20 years. And I moved from a town in New England that has a very successful bike path. And what I was impressed about was that it increased the feeling of community once it was built. And not only did it provide a safe haven for the children after school to go to their extracurricular activities, to get from one another's homes, but it brought out the elderly, people who normally would stay home until the weather was good or until the conditions were perfect for traveling. It got them out to be active, to make new friends. My family and I are very active people. We moved to Cape Elizabeth and discovered it was a very active town also. Anybody can see that on a given weekend going down Shore Road. The bikers, the runners, the walkers, the mothers with baby carriages, I being one with a baby jogger. We were surprised, my husband and I, that with as active as this town is, there wasn't a place to be active. And we highly support this bike path. And I think that you'll find that if there is a showing of hands, that you will find most of the community agrees.
Thank you. Oh, we got to take somebody on this side. Yes, go ahead. There. I couldn't see you there for a while. I thought you went home, but I'll get you next.
Mr. Chairman, council members, my name is Tom Emery. I reside at 12 Juniper Lane. I may be a familiar face to some, but I assure you I'm here this evening as a common citizen of the community. First and foremost, I think that what was said earlier with respect to this being a two-step process at this point in the discussion really should be reemphasized. I think any vote that the council takes tonight is not a vote for or against a bikeway, but more correctly is a vote in order to understand a bikeway. There's a lot of conjecture, a lot of personal opinion, a lot of personal history, a lot of concern about private property that I think, at least at this juncture in the town's history, needs a thorough investigation. And I believe that this is an opportunity to start that. I think it's important to understand who is the bike lane for. I have two children who are now in the middle school who have never biked from our home in Brentwood to Fort Williams, although they've been there every baseball season and every soccer season since they were in preschool. I think that's a shame. I think that there should be an easy way for children to get from the school complex to the premier recreational site in town, and it's my understanding that only with the increasing children population that there'll be more and more demand for recreational use of Fort Williams. There are really several users on Shore Road. I was once a jogger and can testify that if one does not, there are many areas in Shore Road, if one meets oncoming traffic, particularly if there are two cars opposing each other, there's very little room to bail out. And I personally prefer to run in the shoulder, not on the pavement. That is a very dangerous situation, and yet the allure of Shore Road is too great to be avoided by, I think, cyclists, pedestrians, and joggers. There are recreational cyclists. Those are people who are probably middle-aged, who don't cycle often, who would use it as a convenient way to get to Fort Williams or a leisurely Sunday afternoon bike ride to Fort Williams. And then there are the competitive and serious cyclists who may not use the bike lane at all, but who, given an opportunity, will stay in the travel lane. In any event, I think some shoulder would be helpful to anyone in that category. I don't know if it's 4 feet or some other dimension. I would encourage the study to identify several issues. One, the community has recognized Shore Road, and I think people from outside the community equally recognize it as an incredibly important scenic asset to the community. That scenic asset is not just tied to the view that one sees of the ocean, but the experience that one has along the right-of-way. The canopy of trees, the rock outcropping, the wonderful architecture of the houses, the stone walls, and the sort of disorganized natural vegetation. I think the study would allow, once the resources, including where the rights-of-way are, were understood, a study would allow the community to look at alternatives. Every member of this community could come in and see a plan that would show the right-of-way, and they could see for themselves where the walls would be missing, where the lilac hedges would be missing, and what the true impacts would be. And then, in a comprehensive way, we could assess those impacts. Again, we'd have to spend money, but I think it's a critical issue. And one would hope, although I don't believe this, that perhaps, having gone through that study process, that some alternatives other than a 4-foot shoulder on each side of the road could be considered. With respect to the issue of widening, I asked the question, does the lane have to be 4 feet? It's my understanding from a counselor that it has to be a minimum of 4 feet. As a jogger and someone who would like to cycle on that road, even 2 feet would be helpful. The greatest threat to that road, I believe, is not in the widening of the road as much as it is in the federal regulations that might be tied to site distance requirements, horizontal curve alignments, and perhaps the clearing of the right-of-way. And if the right-of-way, if the road were widened, as was mentioned earlier, there's a concern that power lines would be moved back, and as power lines get moved back, the trees get cut further back. That's already happened in some sections of Shore Road. The preservation of the scenic canopy of Shore Road, I think, is absolutely critical to whatever widening might be done. I think as we all travel the straight state roads and see repavement or overlay projects, we've become familiar with the excavator going along the side of the road and digging what I call Georgia ditches. If you go down to Georgia, you'll see all these ditches dug in the side of the road with steep embankments. And those are done because, I guess, the federal government has realized that it's a waste of money to improve road surfaces if drainage isn't handled appropriately. But what gives Shore Road and many other rural roads its unique character is the fact that once you get to the edge of the right-of-way, the trees start immediately or stone walls start immediately. I think a widening of Shore Road would be acceptable if most of the trees could be preserved. I think it would be extremely unacceptable if we're caught into more federal regulations that would have a 3-to-1 slope down to a 3-foot deep ditch and then back up. We don't know what those requirements are yet, and I think that's a good opportunity to, that's something that could be assessed in a study. Most importantly, I think, would be the issue of curbing, which is sometimes required where that one has to meet existing grade. I think Shore Road has the potential to be a recreational resource, much like the jogging path around Back Cove. I think people were wondering why anyone would spend that much money to put a jogging path over Tukey's Bridge, and why in the world would anyone ever want to run around Back Cove. There are many of my neighbors now who drive into Portland, which is one of the great ironies that I have seen, drive into Portland to walk around Back Cove when they could enjoy walking out to Fort Williams. And I guess lastly, having friends who had an old house and were an old family in Lincoln, Massachusetts, the community which did an extensive bikeway system, which was primarily a recreational bikeway system, the bikeway wasn't always a part of a widening of a road, but it meandered in and off the road. I'm not sure that Shore Road has that, but in their bikeway system, they were able to protect the integrity of their unique road widths. And again, I think that's something that could be explored in doing the study. If it comes down to the total loss of the character of Shore Road by flattening the hills, shortening the curves, I don't think it's worth it. But let me just say, I would support and ask that the council at least study bikeways on Shore Road. Thank you.
Thank you. I have one more speaker here, this gentleman here. Then we're going to have a show of hands. Unless somebody, yes, come on. Wait. How many other speakers we got here? We've been at this. Okay.
My name is Jim Cusack. I'm at 31 Lawson Road and have been a jogger on Shore Road. I've survived the last 10 years jogging on Shore Road. And I can survive, but unfortunately now I have two grandchildren at the other end of Shore Road, and they're fortunate to have on that part of Shore Road a sidewalk. And I wouldn't dare suggest that they get on their bicycle on the Shore Road near Oakhurst to bike to my place. It seems to me that we're getting down to an issue of fiscal responsibility and safety. And I say that even if we're paying $500,000, the council might want to consider is the loss or concern of the many safety issues that we have raised here this evening more important than the $100,000, which is all that's being asked of the town, or $500,000. I really think it should not be a question of that when it comes to a difference between safety and fiscal responsibilities. We talk about almost a lost tradition that many schools that are like Cape Elizabeth to be able to bike to school. Would there anybody in this room think of having their child drive or bike along Shore Road to go to school under the current circumstances? Certainly not. And to encourage jogging, which I do regularly, and biking, I think is something that is part of our own tradition that we should be doing here and encouraging, not discouraging. So with the thought that rather than having an endangered species, the children that would and could bike to school or to do, as mentioned previously, bringing our community closer together, and to capitalize on what we have here as an opportunity to go to Fort Williams, we should be encouraging that, not discouraging it. So I'm hard-pressed to find that the widening of Shore Road would not be in the greatest safety interest. And if there is a question of concerning speeding, then that is not part of this evening's discussions. That's a matter of course, the law enforcement. So I would be a proponent for, of course, the bike path and jogging path and a walking path along Shore Road. Thank you.
Thank you. Who's next? Gentleman in the white shirt. Huh?
My name is Bill Riley. I live in the Oakhurst area at 75 Hillcrest Road. Mike, I've got a question for you. If we assume for a moment that the average home in Cape Elizabeth is $200,000, given our current tax rate and the fact that it's going to cost us possibly $100,000, how much over, say, a 20-year amortization would this cost the average homeowner? I dare say it's probably around a dollar a year. Maybe.
I dare say it's too late in the evening for me to figure that one out.
Okay.
The average house is valued at around 160, by the way.
Okay.
160,
so maybe it's only 80 cents instead of a dollar. Based on the safety of what we're, the magnitude of the safety of what we've got, I, for one, would gladly give up that dollar and not have the blood of some persons on my hands. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Lady with the black. Oh, I guess that's Alice.
The lady with the crutch.
It was down with the crowd there, and I couldn't quite pick you out.
Alice Brand from 1222 Shore Road, and I do want to express appreciation to the town council for giving us all an opportunity to speak. Since words are abundant tonight, I will try to use them sparingly. The bike path proposal for Shore Road is of great interest to me, since I am a native of Cape Elizabeth. I won't tell you how old I am, but we did purchase our property 32 years ago in the desire to have our children walk to school, and because although the house was close to the road, the neighborhood was rural, and I consider it still rural, and historic lilac hedges buffered us from traffic. I say that the lilac hedge is historic because they were taken from slips planted by the present Haywood House, formerly Dr. Geneva Tryon, in 1843. Dr. Tryon, a venerable lady psychiatrist, lived in the Haywood House, and I well remember talking with her at age 94 when she vowed to use the last of her legs to walk up to the corner so she could support the bus service. This wonderful, independent lady was proud of the heritage associated with her house and its environs. She gave her 150-year-old lilac slips to our property. In my mind, the bike path would be a travesty against our property, devaluing it by changing the aesthetics to install a 4-foot bike path that would involve more than likely 6 feet more to accommodate culverting and moving telephone poles. We are downhill from the top of Shore Road, and unless culverting is done, water runs down our driveway, eroding its surface. But speaking in a larger sense and thinking of the town as a whole, I believe a bike path would be a travesty against the character of Shore Road and, more importantly, against the comprehensive plan which was adopted by most of this council in 1993. The comprehensive plan is a state mandate document to guide the town in planning. Beyond that, to expend funds which fly in the face of what the townspeople suggested and encouraged through a survey, to me, is an unbelievably extravagant use of funds. I do urge the town council to vote against spending any more time or money on this proposal. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Gentlemen, may I have a... I take it you've been trying to get here.
Yes, I have. You didn't wonder if I...
You're there, John.
John Mitchell, Smugglers Cove Road. I, too, as Michael has, in speaking with a lot of people, several people over the past few weeks, I think there's a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of questions, a lot of issues that need to be clarified. And I'd like to take a few minutes to try to clarify some of the questions that have been asked of me. The pedestrian bikeway path is not an 8-foot or 10-foot wide pathway similar to the one like out on Route 77 with a paved 8-foot lane, nor is it a 5 or 6-foot wide sidewalk with raised curbs like we find in the north part of town on Shore Road. This is a 4-foot paved shoulder that this grant is proposing. Designed to be on both sides of Shore Road, designed for the pedestrian and or bikeway, not just a bikeway, it's for both. The 4-foot dimension will extend from the existing edge of the pavement outward. And I've studied Shore Road, I've walked the entire 2.3 section in both directions. I've studied it very carefully. The plans that you have in your packet were prepared, where the 4-foot pathway was accurately plotted on that, and you can see all of the existing conditions along Shore Road and how they're impacted. I would estimate that somewhere between 85% and 90% of both sides of Shore Road, there already exists a 4-foot shoulder. The problem is the shoulder consists of irregularities, sand, gravel, turf, and it's very difficult to either walk or jog or bike in. I'm a jogger. I know that because of the conditions of the shoulder of Shore Road, I'm forced out into the pavement, which becomes a safety issue. And when two cars are passing one another next to me, I'm forced off Shore Road. Again, other than a few isolated conditions where there are stone walls that are very close to Shore Road, and I've only been able to assess that there are two areas, the entire length of Shore Road on both sides, that stone walls are going to be impacted. I know the DeLuca Hoffman report indicated that there's going to be 1,460 odd feet of stone walls that are going to have to be moved. That simply is not the case. The DeLuca Hoffman reported there are 29 trees that are going to have to be cut. I count 6. And again, I've walked this stretch, I've measured it, I've prepared plans. I think that engineering report is grossly exaggerated. And I think that the people that are concerned about the character are losing the character of Shore Road if this pedestrian bikeway is constructed really has to understand that there's going to be minimal impacts. And the only way that you can really assess that is to get out and do as I have, walk Shore Road, and look for yourself what the dimensional requirements are going to be. Now, I do want to point out that the plans that you have received in your packet show the 4-foot dimension plotted along Shore Road. It does not show those isolated areas where there's going to be an impact as a result of topography or drainage. I fully support the idea of forming a committee, a design review committee, that has been suggested. And I think that that committee should be work very closely and actively with whoever is going to design this project. And finally, and a couple people have already touched upon this, Harold touched on it, and I think this is a very key issue that, the council has to consider. This pedestrian bikeway is going to start connecting the north part of town to the town center. And this is what, from my experience, this is what most towns try to strive for, is pedestrian linkages. And this is, I think, a wonderful opportunity and a unique opportunity that, that we're going to start connecting different parts of town, the north part with the town center, Fort Williams with the town center, with the various neighborhoods. So I think that the council should look at this very positively and very creatively, and I urge your support to vote in favor of this grant. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman in the back there in the red shirt.
My name is Donald Bolduc, and I'm a resident of 78 Old Colony Lane, which is Offshore Road. We've lived there with my family for about 12 years. I'd like to respectfully request that you approve the going forward with the design process. I have two young children that live on the street. It's a one-street neighborhood. You know, I can go on and on about how unsafe it is, but for that primary reason, that the road is unsafe for my children, they're not allowed onto Shore Road and can't take advantage of some of the opportunities that are here at Cape Elizabeth. But rather than spend time tonight trying to gauge the size and the scope and the cost and the implications of this project, because it's too early in that process, and that's what the design process is supposed to do, I sat back and listened to a lot of the previous speakers, and among a diverse group like this, tried to find some common ground among all the speakers. And the only theme that I could come up with was that both supporters and opponents of this particular project view Shore Road as unsafe. It's unsafe for bicyclists and pedestrians. I mean, to me, you know, one of the major thoroughfares in our community, one of our assets, as a lot of people would describe, is unsafe. I don't think too many people would disagree with that. That should shake us to the bone that we haven't addressed it, you know, prior to this. If that road is unsafe, it doesn't matter to me whether it's a bike path or whether it's, as one creative citizen suggested tonight, making the road one way, reducing the speed. If that road is not safe for our citizens, I think it needs to be addressed, and perhaps the design process will shed some light on some potential solutions for that. In fact, public safety, I believe, should be the number one priority, ahead of Cape's rural character, ahead of environmental concerns, ahead of fiscal concerns. Public safety, to me, you know, is very fundamental. And if we're putting some of these other priorities ahead of public safety, I think we need to respectfully re-examine some of our priorities. But I do take thank you for letting us speak here tonight, and
thank you.
Hopefully you'll allow the process to continue.
Thank you. Yes. This gentleman right here, up front, he's been very patient.
Good evening. My name is Jack Lustig, and I reside on Kildare Road, which is off Mitchell Road. I just came down this evening out of interest. I wasn't planning to speak, but as I am listening to a lot of these people, I felt compelled to get up and say something. The greatest majority of the proponents for this particular bike path, walking path, to me, seem to be living on or immediately off of Shore Road. Are they projecting a private recreational domain for themselves? If you are talking about the safety of getting on and off Shore Road for your children, what about the safety of the children, the greatest majority of which live in other parts of Cape Elizabeth? What about the children living in all of the new projects coming on and off Mitchell Road? You couldn't find a more if you want to classify it as such, dangerous road in Cape Elizabeth than Mitchell Road. When are we going to widen that, provide walkways, and provide bike paths? Could you imagine parents leaving their children go from the Mitchell Road area over to Shore Road and using Oakhurst on the bicycle? The dips and the curves in that road are far more dangerous than anything that is on Shore Road. The easiest thing in the world for this town council to do is to accept money. That is only the beginning of it. But once you accept the federal money and you accept the state money, they walk away from the project. Has any thought be given to the maintenance? You have in a very attractive area. How many cars and how many people from the surrounding greater Portland community are going to come in this area? Please consider where they are going to park. Please consider what they are going to use for restroom facilities. We cannot even afford to keep trash barrels in Fort Williams because it costs too much money. What are all these hundreds and thousands of bikers going to do with their trash on Shore Road? Who is going to pay for it? Unpleased pathways like this are creating really a dangerous situation. And ladies and gentlemen, if you don't believe it, I will be glad to escort you on the Beltway or the Greenway in South Portland and walk the length of it with you and see the amount of trash and the amount of items that are found on the side of that pathway. What about our maintenance? Where is that going to come from? Who is going to protect the homeowners on all of these side roads? If you think that these bicyclists are going to be satisfied with just that little stretch of Ocean View and are not going to spread out on all of those side roads, getting down to the shoreline and parking themselves on people's lawns and on the rocks, that is something that I believe you should reconsider, and I believe you should look at the eventual cost of this thing, not the initial cost, but the eventual cost. Don't take the money from these people that will gladly walk away from it and then put all of these provisions on you and saying you must maintain it in such a condition, and please think of the people in the other part of the Cape and don't create a private recreational domain. Thank you.
Thank you. We've got a gentleman back there with the paper up. Maybe everybody's got to get a flag or something.
He's changed his mind.
Mr. Chairman, councilors, thanks for giving us an opportunity to hear about talk with the Shore Road project. Most of what I had in mind.
Your name, please, and address.
Apologies. Amory Houghton, Old Colony Lane. See, I've lived down in the Cape for about close to 35 years, and I came back from having lived here since 1940, so I've been around for a while. And I even remember when Route 77 looked like Shore Road, when Packard's Drugstore was up there, and they cut that off and made it wider.
The good old days.
Yes. in regard to Mitchell Road, two wrongs don't make a right. We'll let it go at that. I think the survey or analysis is important to have. And then perhaps there will be a go, no go when that's done. Shore Road is dangerous. Driving up here, believe it or not, across from the Robinson property, I was behind four cars. The car in front of me passed. I don't care how wide or how narrow it's going to be. They're going to be the idiots who are going to pass. No matter how wide or how narrow. They're going to be those who are going to drive fast, no matter how wide or how narrow. I was a former jogger, and I know it's hard to believe from the physical condition I'm in now, but you want to try jogging Shore Road when one of these tourist bus come by. That's pretty dangerous, and there is not a good place to get off in most areas. Fort Williams is a magnet. Fort Williams draws. It draws busloads. It draws carloads. It draws out-of-state people. It's free, and I've advocated a little fee there, so I'll get that bit in. When they get done with seeing Fort Williams and hopefully spending a little money there, they head for Two Lights or Crescent Beach. And the easiest way to get there is up Shore Road. So no matter what we do, we've acted as a magnet, drawn these people in. Now, I think we have to address stone walls very carefully. I think we have to address lilac bushes very carefully. Nobody wants to destroy what is aesthetically beautiful. As far as trash goes, I have traveled that. My wife and I travel it, and while we're very strong, we oftentimes, now that we too are on a fixed income, walk up to the drugstore and grocery store. It's good for our health, but it's debatable sometimes with the traffic. I have one question that I would like to ask, and this concerns the $61,000 for town center sidewalks. I see sidewalks up there that go down to Pond Cove Shopping Center, go down beyond over the hill and past the skating rink area, the Little League ball field. I don't know what that additional $6,000 is going to be used for, but it sounds to me like it doesn't really need to be done. Now, I have not seen a plan. I don't know what it involves. I don't know where they're going to go, but we seem to have sidewalks there now, and perhaps I'm just not aware of it, but it almost seems like here's $61,000, maybe we can use elsewhere. The last comment is I was fortunate enough to spend some time in Switzerland and Austria, and more recently visiting friends of ours in Canada, and they are putting bike paths in and walk paths, and we have an opportunity to do it. We may never have that chance again, and I think that the best thing we can do is to do it. I have seen many young people from Old Colony Lane heading towards the high school, grade school more than likely, heading down to Fort Williams with tennis rackets, and we've just been very fortunate that we have not had an accident, and I hope we never do, regardless of the outcome of this thing, obviously. Thank you for your time, and I really do solicit affirmative votes from the council. Thank you.
Gentleman in the back with the green sweater there. There's a few seats down front here if anybody there care to stay around a while longer and would like to have a chair. Go ahead, sir.
My name is Richard Sullivan, and I've lived in the Cape since 1976. And I commuted from 1068 Shore Road to Portland by bicycle from 1977 till 87. And I've commuted by bicycle from 72 Two Lights Road from 1987 until the present time. And I view the two roads as very different. And I'd like the council to try to make that distinction. As a biker on Shore Road, I was often uncomfortable with the traffic that I was commuting in. Whereas in Two Lights Road, I feel that the road at present is very safe for bicycles and pedestrians. There are long straightaways. The shoulders are wide and afford for pedestrians easy access to get off the road. And so Two Lights Road, from my perspective, is safe presently for pedestrians and bikers. Secondly, on Shore Road, you're talking about moving lilac bushes and stone walls. And on Two Lights Road, we're talking about taking 6 feet off of front yards, which are already too close to the road. Jeannie Jordan's house is 19 feet from the road. Ted Hollidge's front porch are 15 and a half feet. The slope that leads to the road from my house is 14 feet from the road. So you subtract 6 feet for a bike path on each side, and you're taking old historic houses and really compromising and changing these settings. And finally, I feel that widening Two Lights Road by 12 feet from 21 to 33 feet will very significantly alter the rural character of the road. This road has been there for 200 years, and it has served our neighborhood very well, and it has been a source of satisfaction to us, and it resonates with our rural heritage and character. And by widening this road, it seems to me will be just creating another suburban environment, no different from many other parts of the country. So I urge you to think carefully, and I think you can weigh the pros and cons on Shore Road in terms of safety and aesthetics and property rights. But in Two Lights Road, it seems to me the balance very clearly lies in the area of let's preserve this historic area. Thank you.
Thank you. Look at him come up. Gentleman on the corner over there with the glass. Right there, you're right. Stand up. What did you say? Oh, is that who? I didn't recognize you there in the corner.
My name is Michael Roy. I live at 51 Hillcrest Road. And at the outset, I'd like to apologize. I'm much less prepared than the other speakers here this evening, and I beg your indulgence. I'm here to speak in favor of this proposal. I came here tonight with that bias, but I did come here tonight with an open mind. And I've tried to sit back tonight, as other speakers have, I'm sure, and other people here, to think and ponder some of the arguments that have been raised. As I've sat and listened to what's been said, I've been struck by a number of tensions in the various arguments that have been brought up. There is the tension between safety and aesthetics. And in my mind, safety wins hands down. There is the tension between fiscal responsibility and, I guess, wanton spendthriftness, however you want to say, between pork and oat bran. I don't know what the analogy would be, but there is that tension between being fiscally responsible and not, I guess. There is, importantly, I think, a tension in this room between what is, what the reality of Shore Road is, and what we would like it to be. And there are many of us here, maybe all of us here, would like Shore Road to be this nice, winding country lane. And there are certain times of the day, I guess, where it does look that way. But I think the reality is very, very different, and dangerously so. The reality is that that is a road that is very, very heavily traveled by both Cape Elizabeth residents and non-residents, tourists who are unfamiliar with the road, etc. That is the reality that this town must deal with. And I think that that reality raises significant safety issues that have to be addressed, that cannot be ignored. And if they are ignored, will only one day lead to a great tragedy. I would also like to address the fiscal arguments that have been raised tonight. To my mind, those are some of the most myopic arguments I've heard tonight. If you take this $112,000 and divide it by the 3,000 some odd households in this town, you're talking about 30 some odd dollars per household. And then, of course, as Bill Riley's pointed out, if you amortize that over years, it's a trivial expense. Furthermore, the balance, the $450,000 or whatever it is money that we've paid in taxes. And it's not very often that Cape Elizabeth gets money from the federal government as a handout like this. And it's money that rightfully should be coming back to us. Finally, and I know that's sort of reiterating other points, but finally I would just make this point that has not been made before. And that is by projects like this that I believe enhance the quality of life in Cape Elizabeth, that connect people to their town center, that make this a safer place to live, will in fact enhance property values, which is our primary basis for income in this town. And I think that that cannot be ignored. I think you have to look at the big picture here. So I strongly urge the council to proceed with this design process. Thank you.
There's a lady standing back there, way back. She's been standing up quite a while. Maybe we'll get down.
I'm Rebecca Smith from Broad Cove Road, and I've lived in Cape all but 6 years of my life, which the other six were spent just up Cottage Road a little ways from Shore Road. It's because I've loved this town all my life, and I'm the last person that would want to change the character because I've seen it change so drastically over the years, especially Shore Road where I grew up on Beach Bluff Terrace, the canopy of trees, the lilacs, the stone walls and all. But I'm sure with the way this town works together and the way the council works with the town that we can come up with some plan that will be satisfying to the majority of members of this town to put a bike path, jogging path, walking path down Shore Road and Two Lights Road. I want to make a point because it seems as though not many people are aware of how dangerous these roads really have been. One of our neighbors lost a child on Two Lights Road because of the curviness of the road and because the child was riding their bike. When you say that this, are we going to wait till this happened? It already has happened. That's a tragedy. And when I thought about this bike path being built, the first thing I thought, along with the different times through the years they've proposed the town bus coming down through Shore Road and sidewalks being put down, nothing compares to the life of a child. He'll never live to be 90 years old, like that lady with the lilacs. Which is a beautiful story, and I think that's great. It's part of our heritage, but that child will never see that day. There was another child on our street who was, thank God, not hit by a school bus, but he was riding his bike on a narrow part of the road which didn't have a shoulder, and the bus was coming by, and he just hit some small obstacle in the road, and his body went right into the wheel of a 25-mile-an-hour school bus. If he was inches ahead of that, he would have been under that wheel. How many close calls have we had that we don't all hear about? Obviously, a lot of you haven't heard about the one on Two Lights Road. So I think we need to really consider the safety issue. How can you take that right away from a child? Thank you.
You're welcome. Where do we go from here? We got a gentleman right here in the second row who's been very patient.
Good evening, I'm John Boomer from 9 Delano Park, and I need to start off by saying I'm against widening roads. Several years ago I worked on the group that stopped the widening of the main turnpike. So whenever anybody talks about widening Shore Road, that doesn't work for me. On the other hand, I and my housemate feel like prisoners in our own neighborhood. When we want to take a walk or ride a bike, we're scared by the speed and density of traffic on Shore Road. In the beginning, ways and roads were for people. Only later has the high-speed auto pushed us out of the way and into the ditch. I feel the need to fight back and create safe, enjoyable pathways. What I have been hearing, the theme tonight, is people versus cars. Detroit versus us. And it sounds like there is a possible opportunity here to lead the town in a different direction. And I would propose a compromise that would create a pathway that would be near the road, not on the road, for people and moderate speed bicycles. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes. Now back, this gentleman back there with a gray sweater on the left. Is it gray, white, red shirt? Okay, come up. I guess you'll have to wait, I guess.
Next time, let's have numbers.
It's a good idea.
My name's David Wing, 80 Oakhurst Road. I am, in no particular order, a cyclist, a father, a taxpayer, a driver. My particular bias, to some extent, is explained by the fact that This shoe is built up because this leg is longer from an unfortunate incident with a car on my bicycle briefly, then off my bicycle and most of the way into the car. It wasn't a lot of fun. Not much fun at all. Shore Road is an extremely dangerous road for cyclists, for pedestrians, for mothers with baby carriages, for dogs, on and on. I don't happen to spend a lot of time on Two Lights Road, so I'm not going to talk about that. I find it very disheartening that there's such vehemence against even considering giving non-motorized traffic a fair chance along what is a very pretty road, but it's also about the only way to get from a lot of Cape Elizabeth to the rest of Cape Elizabeth. No one is fonder of lilacs than I am. Lilacs grow. You can always move the darn things or plant new ones if it should be necessary. Until we have a design that can be evaluated, I think it's divisive, premature to spend a lot of time worrying about whose ox will be gored. Thank you.
You're welcome. Just a minute. The gentleman there that started down before, thank you.
Well, my name is Richard Berman. I live at 1021 Shore Road. And I don't have to tell you how dangerous Shore Road is for pedestrians and bicyclists. So I'm in favor of improvements for pedestrians and bicyclists. I'm not in favor of increasing the speed on Shore Road. I'm not in favor of increasing automobile traffic or bus traffic on Shore Road. And I'm not in favor of changing the character of Shore Road. I'm also not in favor of being physically irresponsible. And I am sensitive to our senior citizens in the town, especially those on fixed incomes. I'm wondering, I heard a couple of, I think I'm in favor of studying this, but it sounds like the study is really aimed at just proving whether this 4-foot widening on each side will do the job and how much cost it will do the job. And it seems you're headed down a path where the design is preconceived already. My fear is that by widening Shore Road by 4 feet on either side, traffic will increase in speed, that Shore Road will be easier to drive along, that because of that ease,